while at work, even at work, you can see those who are at more than three floors or four floors, you can see kites coming in and going out. You can see pigeons which are coming in and going out. So doves which are on the higher perches. From the kitchen window, yeah, this kitchen window is mostly you will see crows, but from kitchen window also, if you have a balcony view from the kitchen window, you can see the birds as well. So this birding activity actually breaks the monotony of dull routine. Those who are doing weekend birdings, like early morning, because the timing for birding is very limited we have. And early morning time is best for getting the bird shots and late afternoon. So the monotony of your dull routine will be changed every day. So you can finish your morning birding, then get refreshed and go to office. So like that. So this is a very, that is why most of the people enjoy this activity day in, day out. I have seen people who have been walking day in, day out for the whole year, and they keep on updating their database for seeing new birds every day, because each month the birds activity, the bird numbers, the bird species changes. So going ahead, so this is a small note sheet which I usually ask my team members to have with them. So if you can see, there is a small sparrow on the left hand side, then comes the crow, then comes the kite, and then comes the pelican. So these are the dotted ones, lines are like you are seeing the smaller species of birds. Even though you can't identify, at least you can write down the color of that species. You can write down the time. You can write down the place where you have seen that. So these different sizes, and in between of these, now there will be a bird, maybe a parrot, a parakeet or a myna, which is in between these sparrow and crow. So you can write down in between these things and keep noted. Think, because you will not remember once you have done the taken the photos, gone home, you will not be able to remember what it exactly is. So if you remember, at least when you are sending it or IDing this bird species, if you have some of the details, it will be easy for anybody who is identifying the birds to answer, especially the place, the color, and the time will help them to identify whether those birds were available in that area, so that it will be useful and easy for anybody who is identifying the birds. So let's go ahead and start the exact identification of birds basically. So everybody would have seen these kind of activities and thinking of what is this bird exactly doing. The kida to know, kida is like, the why is this doing, what is this exactly doing. Most of them would have seen all these activities, some of them would have not seen all the activities, but these are the basic activities which differs from their daily activities. So first is called as anting. So anting is, there is an anthill under this bird. What it does is, it goes and sits on front of that red ants, especially the red ants. So where a folic acid is sprayed, or you know, the ants spray their urine for making the their enemies to go away. So that uric acid is a folic acid which sprays on their feathers, which acts as an antiseptic for their birds. So when they are going to be going for feeding, it will be easy for them that none of the counter attacks are happening, because it, this acts as a complete blockage for them. This is called as anting. So next come preening. Most of them would have seen preening activity. Early morning by 6:30, 6:45, if you have seen any bird for that matter, every bird will be on their top perch where there will be sun basking. After that, they will be releasing the feathers and cleaning the feathers. This happens with butterflies as well. So in the night, the dew drops which are fallen on the bird's feathers will make the feathers stick together. So what it does, how we comb our air, it is the same thing which happens with birds, where it starts cleaning or preening the feathers, which makes the feathers and their flight very easy. You can see after the preening activity, they start eating or they start hunting. That is what happens. So the third one is pecking. Most of you would have seen who have sparrows near their house or bulbuls near their house, sometimes even crow. So they will be pecking the mirror glass, which not only mirror glass, even the vehicle's mirrors, because it is an activity. What first you will see a male pecking the mirror, and then you will see the female pecking the mirror. It is the inferiority complex of the male which makes that pecking activity. So when it sees the male, so it can realize that some other male is there which is trying to attract the female which is there. So after a while, when the female comes and starts pecking, female also thinks that the male which is already with him is going to fall for that female. So this activity is called as pecking. Most of them would have seen courtship displays. This is, I have given a peacock as an example. There are lots of others. Most of them have seen Amazon, beautiful birds of Amazon. So this courtship display happens when there is a female in front of it. Most of them say when there is rain is falling and all those things. No, it is not like that. The courtship display is always when there is a female around a male peacock or a male bird. So it happens with all the species. It is not only with one species. So we have hurt wing display. This happens with mom and kids basically. See, the mother always try to defend the nest. The mother always tries to defend the nest, and most of them, what happens is these are the birds which are there at the shores or which are there at the open areas. So what happens, the female bird which has laid the eggs or with the chicks has been born, to divert it from the predators who are attacking from above. What this does is it works as a wing, a hurted wing, and tries to move away from that nest. When the predator sees that this bird is unable to move, it is easier for them to catch, it tries to come and catch the bird, and this bird will just get ready and fly off, confusing the predator and also saving their chicks. This aggressive display is will happen whenever there is, it is mostly in the mating season and when there are two males versus one female. The aggressive display is very high. Otherwise, their territory, they are aggressive. Most of the time, you would have seen lapwings. You have heard of lapwings. So that is one of the species which is a ground dweller. So what happens over there is they just doesn't like any other form of species. It might be a cat, a dog, a human, whoever it is. 20 meters, 30 meters from them, 40 meters from them, it starts shouting. It shows this aggressive display. And if it has laid eggs, it tries to fly on top of you and come and hit you with their beaks. So those are the aggressive display. This is just one of the examples which has been there. So usually in typical study of birds, they have been categorized. Those are planning to do environmental science. Those are planning to do PhD on one of the species of birds. The typical study basically happens like this. So the study of birds with respect to feathers, there are so many subcategories. With respect to sound, migration, and nest, it is just one single category because each has their own specific data to be accumulated. With features, we have body, wings, beak, feet, and different types of all these kinds we have. So those who are trying to do or planning to do a study of birds, these behavioral aspects and the features are very important. So it's quite challenging to identify the birds at first. Everybody are bird up from their childhood. Everybody knows crow, everybody knows sparrow, everybody knows eagle, even though it's a kite, but people know it as eagle. Everybody knows pigeon. Most of them know bulbuls as well. So everybody are bird up from childhood, but identifying a different species You have to contend basically to know what they are, especially. And but we have lots of clues which the birds have been giving us, and these clues are being used from 1600. So the bird book, the identification of birds or birding, is a quite old bird watchers basically, the from the starters. So the bird watchers have been there from 1600. Otherwise, you would have not known that dodo was the bird which was available for us, so which has been extinct. So the kind, these kind of things. So these are few things which helps us to identify the birds. The shape, the size, beaks and feet are some, sound and color, place of sighting, time and day of the year, which is very important. Those who are specifically searching for a bird to have in their database. So let's go ahead. So these are the body parts. Most of them would be, you guys would have heard that red whiskered bulbul, red wattled lapwing, yellow wattled lapwing. So what else? White-cheeked barbet. So you would have heard, why are they giving the nomenclature with respect to only these things? So to your left hand side, you can see the birds' specific parts like eye, beak, head and crown, wings, tail, claws and belly. These are the six items which are used to identify the birds. So the right hand side is an anatomy of it, but these are the nomenclature terms which we use. Red beak, white beak, silver bill, white belly, woodpecker, then we have crested serpent eagle. So all these things are used only with these parts. So these are the parts which are usually used for nomenclatures or giving the names specifically. And most of the birds have already been given the names, but either with their known people or with their known words, they have already defined the birds. We don't have any new species of birds which are there. We will have subspecies of the same bird. So with respect to size and shape, as I was telling you, you define yourself with a small chart which has like different sizes for you guys to identify it. So from small to large shape, we have like the smaller birds like sunbird, tailor bird, tits, robin. Then the next size would be sparrow. With respect to sparrow and myna, in between we have starlings, bioweaver, drongos. So from myna to crow, we have shikara, black kite. So we have a mixture of predators and prey with us for all the size and shapes. A very peculiar bird called a falconet is there, which is the size of a sparrow, but even an eagle and a kite fears it because it can attack from ground to top directly. And it is the size of a sparrow, a little bit bigger than a sparrow, but it's sparrow, in between sparrow and myna. So we have such interesting birds. We have the biggest ones are ostriches and emu, which are not there here. All have been imported. The biggest crane what we have is a saurus crane. Then comes the domicile cranes. So saurus cranes, usually those who have been to Ghana before, like 6-7 years back, they would have been seeing in the migratory season. Now you have to move ahead of Ghana to watch it because of, again, human intervention into their areas. So we have different kinds of beaks and eating habits which define them. So we have a generalist, all would have seen a generalist, which is a crow. We have insect catching, those have seen beaters, those are all insect catching. So we have, and also swallows, they are all insect catching. We have grain eating, we have sparrow, myna, we have, munia. We have munia, we have silver bills, all this. So confectuous seed eating, we have bulbuls, which eats all those things. Nectar feeding, sunbird, everybody would have known of the sunbirds. Fruit eating, here this is a token for the photo, but We have so many fruit eating birds. The bigger ones are hornbills. We have greater hornbills, Malabar grey hornbills, we have pied hornbills, Indian pied hornbills, we have crowned hornbills in India. So we have, those are our fruit bears, and we also call hornbills as farmers of bird kingdom, because whenever they take these seeds, they go at least 50 kilometers away and come back with the best fruits which they have, which is ripened, and the seeds are again on the ground, which is making the plants to regrow. We have chiseling. This is a everybody would have known woodpecker. So one interesting fact of chiseling or a woodpecker is it has different techniques of attracting a female. It has different how the other birds use voice or a chirping sound. The woodpecker uses knocking. So it gives different, those who have heard woodpecker knocking. So whenever they have different kinds of, it suggests different kinds of woods. One is for mating calls, one is for searching for food, one is for nesting. All three, it uses different kinds of chiseling. For mating calls, it hits at least 600 to 700 times in a minute. And like how we have shock absorbs in our vehicles, the chisel based any woodpecker, it has a soft cushion on top of its brain. And also it has one more shock resistant diaphragm in between those two, which help them not to break the barrier of the head, because hitting it so many times per minute will break its head, break anybody's head for that matter, except for woodpecker. So we have deep netting. Deep netting, most of them would have seen pelicans. We have probing. Probing is like they search for the algae which are inside the water. They just keep on using their beak to search the small insect, crabs, and algae. We have filter feeding. Everybody knows about flamingo. It keeps its head inside. They have a clear outlet in their beaks, which will help them to filter the mud versus the algae which they have. So we have aerial fishing, kingfisher. Everybody knows about kingfisher. Pursuit fishing. So you have to go for pelagic birding to exactly enjoy the pursuit fishing. We have some in deep areas of forest to see pursuit fishing. So what this pursuit fishing does is it acts like wolf of our other species. So there will be one which will be pursuing, and there will be others which will be just waiting for it to eat. That is just one technique which they use. Other than that, they dive very deep. They go very behind the fishes, pursues it for a long time, and then they are going to grab. Scavenging is there. Scavenging, we have kites, which are scavengers. So the difference between eagle and kite, or the raptorial and the scavenging, is scavenging don't try to hunt anything. They just scavenge for a dead meat or whichever they get, the dead meat which are there. So that's why you see most of the kites which are near the market area where there is a mutton stall or a chicken stall, you find them more. But versus the raptorial, the eagles, they hunt and eat. They don't scavenge, they hunt, they search. Those who have seen crested serpent eagle or a changeable hawk eagle pursuing a squirrel or a snake or a lizard or any smaller species, a hare for that matter. So they hunt and eat. Those is the difference between a raptorial behavior and a scavenging behavior. This would be most of the people who will be asking me what would be the difference. So we have different kinds of feet to identify as well when we are through with it. So we have a raptor style grasping, like woodpecker, parakeets. All those things have grasping legs. So they can actually walk sideways, upwards, downwards, all those words, all those sides. So we have perching birds, which perches for their food. Even though most of them would have seen chicken legs also. We have swimming birds. So there's a small video which is done for a 3-year-old kid. So I'll just play it for let me know if you guys can hear it out. Mukesh sir, I need your help for this. If you can tell me if the sound is available.
Sure. You need to take out your earphone during this video, then it start using the internal mic.
Oh, okay.
We cannot play this video.
Okay.
We cannot hear, but we can read the description, so please carry on.
muted.
Ganesh, on the voice, you can keep talking, actually, since we cannot hear your voice.
Okay,
Ganesh, I think you need to connect your earpiece now.
Yeah, I just plugged it in. You're able to hear me?
Yes, loud and clear. Please continue.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you, thank you. So next we will go with colors. So most of them would have known this before itself. The male have the prominent colors over the female. So this is because there also there is a fight for females every time. So they need to have beautiful colors. They need to attract the females. That is the reason they are always more beautiful than females. Yeah. So this is the first example. Like we have the common one,
yeah.
Peacock and a peahen. So we have other species which you can identify as a male and a female difference. So most of them, when you are seeing a little bit more colorful birds, including the crow, when there is a plumage, you can see the gray neck has completely turned into a bluish kind of a tinge for their in their neck. That is whenever they are into mating season. So The minivets. The second one is a minivet, which is an orange minivet, the most beautiful bird. Identifying that is also like one male, two females always. So there will be one orange, two yellow. Mukesh sir, I think yours is not.
Buddy log out. Okay. Sorry.
Okay. So the third one is orioles. So I'm just given a few examples, which are most of them would have seen in their gardens or park whenever they are walking. So the oriole is also very beautiful bird. They have very good vocals as well. So the male will always have prominent colors for plumage and other stuff. So the plumage is mostly used for getting the females. There is no other use of it. The color radiance is for getting the females. Okay, so most of them would love to identify the birds by seeing them. But the most difficult part is you can't spot a bird directly when there is a big bush or a tree which is there. So you have to identify the other ways. The most difficult part, that is the sound. You know the sound is coming from one part of the tree. You are searching for it, you will not be able to know. And you will not be able to know which bird it is as well, because you are not seeing it through your eyes. So the most important one for birding is hearing. So this also is for wildlife as well. If you are very keen on wildlife photography or wildlife behavior studies and other stuff, sound is very important, because that gives you a heads up of where you have to exactly look into. So most of us are visually oriented. That means we can tell what the bird is as soon as we see the bird. By hearing the sound, what the bird is by knowing. It is a simple example for this. So you know your friend's voice when they are calling you by the name. You know who is calling you. So that is the same thing which happens with wildlife or with birding as well. So you know which bird is being calling you only when you repeatedly hear the sound and know that is the bird which is available or which you have seen before and you have seen the sound before. So that is an example which is very important, to use sound as the main thing. So we definitely cannot be dependent on our eyesight, because when you are inside the forest or when you are putting your bird barrier, taking the photos, you will never know from where you are hearing the sounds. So, and most of the birds are shy, very shy. The predators are very, very modalistic birds. Other than that, most of them are very, very, very shy. And you will definitely see them running away from you as soon as they see you. If you consider for peacock, 50 meters away you are walking, it hears your or it feels the vibration, it is gone. You will not be able to get the capture photo of what you are exactly looking for. So like that. Visually it's easy to remember, but bird songs you have to memorize. You have to pin down on sounds. Why I'm stressing this is those who are learning to do birding, it is a good practice for them to start also learning the behaviors and the sounds which is incorporated for the birds. Otherwise, you know there is a bird, but you will not be able to find it out where it is. The one more important thing which is there is the brain size of the bird. From a green gram to an apricot, the brain size of the bird varies. Those have seen smaller birds. This is an example I am giving you so that you will know, you would be knowing it with realistic things what happened to you guys itself. So sparrows, robins, maybe tits or smaller birds for that matter, which is having a very less memory for them. So we call them from few minutes to their life. So these smaller birds have very less memory with them. Once you are seen in their environment, it tries to fly away. But if you are settling there for more than 10 to 15 minutes, you are able to see them. They are coming near you. They are coming next to you, sitting next to you. They are doing their work. They are not going to be considering you as any form of threat. So this is because, one more example I can tell, those who have seen the farming areas. So you would have seen egrets which are like in hundreds of numbers next to them. But as soon as you go near it to take the photos, all will fly off. The reason is you are not in their environment. They have not seen you in that environment. Yet they have not accustomed you guys in their environment. So that is why when you go for a zoo or when you go for a bird sanctuary, birds are not afraid of you guys because it has seen most of these kind of people with cameras, with focusing towards them, and they don't feel that as a threat. But any other birds for that matter, you have to give them time and you have to be there in their environment for at least 15 minutes to 20 minutes for you to get the best photos. You might be thinking, why are these guys getting better photos than us even though you are going at the right time? You're not giving enough time for that bird to come near you and give you the best shot. That's all. That is the easiest thing. So not to forget the nesting and roosting. This is an interesting thing. So when you are doing your migratory season birding, or when you are going for monsoon birding, or even when you are going to LRK or any other areas, most of the time, each bird has different time of their breeding. If you see all these predators, they do from March till June, because the dry season, the insects or the grasshoppers are very easy. They can get high proteins for their kids. So then comes the monsoon season. The smaller birds will try to do at that point of time, because monsoon, too many spiders are there. And they have, again, lots of protein which they get for their food, for breeding. So, and from October till June, the migratory birds, you would enjoy the migratory birds. It might be flamingos, storks, or cranes, or geese, whichever you are searching behind. So these all define themselves with respect to their nesting and roostings. So the migration happens only for two things. One is for food, one is for mating or family. So let's start from the left side. So penguin doesn't need any sort of nest. It keeps the egg in between their legs, and that is enough for them. So they don't need any form of cavity for the eggs to be staying there. If you have seen penguin legs, they are a little bit broad, and they already, when they cover up, it will be in the shape of L. So that is more than sufficient for penguins to hold. You might also see some of the pigeons, which are mostly in the city areas. They don't need any nest. They just keep three twigs in a triangular shape, and that is enough for them, for the egg not to move from that place. So next comes the floating. Those have seen jacanas, water murrain, water hen, purple murrain, all those birds. They are all do their nesting in their floating swarms in the water. Then comes the flamingos, which are at the shore level. And those are gone to Pulicat Lake, or those are gone to Raichur, or gone to Pune for these, or even for LRK. They would have seen the huge burrows which are there, and they have a cavity as well in between the egg as well as their legs. So when they are sitting inside the nest, the base of the bird will go and set the on top of the eggs, so that the cavity holds the eggs, and then the legs are completely down. Then we have a burrow system of birds. These are like plovers. Some of the plovers are there, which goes into the burrow system. Turkeys are there, which does full mound mud, compounded mud, which keeps them in the heat. We have lapwing, which just lays its egg on the ground with little bit of cavity. We have lapwing, we have tichne, which does these things. In tree, we have seen, most of them would have seen the nests in the tree itself. the pendant system, the most important and even Salim Ali's favorite is Baya weaver. So most of them know about the weavers. They are upside down. They build 7 to 9 nests. Each male will have 7 to 9 females or 7 to 9 homes for their chicks. We have cavity system inside the trees, which can be a woodpecker, which can be an owl as well, owlet as well. We have a dome system, cockles, greater cockle they would have seen, or even they would have seen crows, which are there. Brood parasite, all know about the nightingales. It doesn't need any nest. It goes and lays this egg on any of the nests which are available in that area. So that is a brood parasite. We have flatworm. Most of the cranes, storks, what we see. Those have been to, in South, those have been to Rangantitu. They will have bird sanctuary we have where they can see. And most of the pelicans, they need the higher grounds. They need the flat surface of the tree to have a platform to make their nest. The cup system, again, we have the dome and cup is almost similar type of things. So we have a cup thing. Those who have seen the paradise flycatcher. So they all have this cup system with their, they use the eggs to hold in that cup system where it is easy for the chicks to not to fly away or fall away from the holders. The next comes the most interesting tailor bird. So most of them would have seen about the tailor bird. So tailor bird, if you have observed the tailor bird nest, they don't pluck the leaves from their branches. They stick 2 to 3 leaves which are stuck to the branch, because if they remove the leaf from the branch, it is going to dry. So they are not going to remove it from the branch and they are going to stitch. That is how they use. So we have kingfishers, which is a cavity system. That is why most of them cannot find the nesting of a kingfisher, because they go very deep and then they have a cavity inside and they lay their eggs there. The same thing happens for some of the owls as well, but they do it in the wood trunks. We have ledges. Most of them have seen the eagles in the National Geographic or BBC or Animal Planet. The ledges are used for predators, basically away from all these kind of snakes and other stuff which eats the chicks or the egg. We have adherent cups, the swallows, the swifts, they use the cup, adherent cup, which are stuck high above the rocks in an inclined way where it is difficult for a snake or a predator to hold on and get it. So this is about the roosting and nesting. Anything I miss here? Yeah, I have missed about the hornbills. So hornbill is a very interesting bird. They are mated for life, for that matter. So everybody would have heard that hornbill, if a father dies, the whole family is going to die. Because when the mother is nesting, they find a hollow trunk. And they don't use any sort of other twigs or leaves to make the nest. It uses its feathers. The female uses its feathers, plucks the whole feather and makes it as a nest or a bed for the nest, for the eggs to be laid. And once the egg comes out from there till the chick becomes a subadult and starts to fly, till that time, it is going to be inside that hollow trunk. So if the male doesn't get the food to those female and the chick, they are going to die. So where to find them? So this is an interesting question everybody will be having in their mind. Where to find birds? So you can find in all these places. So where to watch birds? Again, this is an interesting one. So we have forests, shrublands, mountains, wetlands, seashores, cities. So all areas we have birds. Just that you have to define what bird you are really going to see. So where to spot them. So this is the most important thing for those who are taking photographs, because where to spot them will help you guys to understand what time you have to be there, what is that you are searching, why you are searching, all these things. So early hours from 6:30 from the sunrise. Now it is summer, so it is 6:15, 6:10 till 7:38. You can see all the birds on the topmost perches, which it uses for preening, drying, sunbasting. And then after 9:30, you can start seeing birds coming down because of the sun. Again, sun, it will be on highest in the afternoons, and most of the birds get tired if they are flying. So they go inside the branches. Yeah. So by evening, it starts coming to the lower side of the trees for perching or roosting. So we have some birds which are there on the ground, like egrets we have, paddy pipits we have pita, Indian pita we have robins, which are rock dwellers. So we have small preenas, we have babblers, we have Indian eagle owl, we have, which are all on the ground level, which you can, if you are observing, you can see them on the ground level. So near the water belt, we have thrushes, we have herons, we have kingfishers, we have painted sparfowls as well in the both the areas, near the water dwelling as well as in the rock dwellings. The whole temples, mosque, churches, you will find spotted owlets, bats, and some small species of predator birds, which you guys would have observed in between those small cracks of two pillars. You will find the spotted owlet there. That's the easiest way to get a spotted owl. So once we have, other than the land, we have birds in the oceans as well, birds in the water kingdom as well. We call that as pelagic birding. So there are some interesting birds which we will only see in the ocean, or which we see only see in the shores. So the water birds are, we have kingfisher also is there, heron, cormorant is there, western egrets are there, we have seagulls which are in the ocean, flamingos, we have gray fish owl, we have barred-headed geese, we have skua, terns. So these are some of the birds which are the skimmers we have. So when to find them? I believe in triple P. First, you know the path where you have usually heard or known of things getting in and out, weather change routes, migration routes, that is the path. Second is part, which is the common part of the ecosystem. You cannot find an Indian monol in South India. You have to go to the northeastern India. The same way you cannot see an Indian pita in North India. So like this, you need to know the ecosystem of that bird, which part is known for that ecosystem. Then comes the patch. So it can be any patch which you know from your backyard. For example, 2 kilometers from your place, there might be an open ground or an open land of around 5-6 acres. Where some of the uncommon species of birds would have been there, and you would have been seeing them once in a while. So you know your backyard very well. So which patch of bird to go and attack is should be your idea. So this is what I call it as triple P's. So these three will help you to define exactly which path or which part or which patch of land to be seen. The migration paths, most of them know of Amur falcon. They are one of the second longest migratory birds which pass through India. So from Mongolia, it goes to Africa and comes back to Mongolia through the same route. So most of them would have heard about the Nagaland Amur falcon killings and other stuff. which converted into a very good conservation, and now the killing has gone up, stopped up to 96%. The other thing is like Arctic terns. Those who have seen or heard about Arctic terns, they travel from Arctic to Antarctic, Antarctic to Arctic. That is the for their whole year, June to August, they just come into the northern part, and December to April, they come to the south part. So they are also the fastest travelers as well, which go from north of the world to the south of the world. So these are the few examples of migration part. So which part of India is what kind of bird? This you can get it online as well. So you can check which are the birds you are looking for, like Great Indian Bustard, which might be which might also be any other birds which you are seeing, lesser flamingos if you are seeing, all those kind of details you will get it online as well. So this is where I am going to end my session, and if you guys have any questions, please shoot. Mukesh, over to you.
Unmuted.
So this is the first part of our session. We will start with our questions, then we will have a session with Sigma. So first part of will any question you have, you guys can put it in our chat session. There is an option available for you on your devices. You can also raise your hand and we will unmute you so that you can ask your question. So we will start with some of the voice question. We have two hands raised right now. One is from Sabyasachi Maji. You are unmuted, please ask your question. And the second one will be taking Prashant's question. So Sabyasachi or Prashant, please go ahead.
Actually, I want to know what will be the best time for clicking the peaks in the morning.
Your voice is breaking up. The best time for?
For clicking the image for birds in the morning.
Okay. Best time. It again defines from what level you are taking the photo. So yeah. Usually so from actually, 6. Yeah. Tell me, please.
When they spend time in the lake, actually they are very active. I have followed a few birds. So actually they are, when I can target them, it's the laser time, so I can have a little bit better time to click.
See, the most of the smaller birds are very active in the morning, so they will be jumping around till 7:30 to 8. Okay, once they have fed themselves for the first round, it will be easy for you to get their photos. If you are going very early morning, they will be after preening, they start to keep on having very high activity for feeding.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the answer. We have another question which is asked by a couple of people, that bird photo, should we take it in landscape or in portrait mode orientation? What's your thought on that? Which picture looks better?
Yeah, if you are taking a bird with its environment, it is always better to take in landscape, because you are showing the environment where you have taken the bird's photo. But if you are only focusing on the bird or half of the bird, it is very good to take in portrait mode.
Okay. It's a very, because you are in the field, like how to control lights, like how to be at the right spot for taking the picture, because the environment is not controllable, light is not in your control. But what all the tips and tricks you can suggest for controlling the light or using the utilization of the light, I would say.
Yeah, usually. Most of the time, if you keep your ISO to auto, let the camera control your light. Because most of the time what happens, we will be, especially when we are taking the birds in flight and birds which are very active in the early mornings, it will be very difficult for us to control the lighting, because the shutter speeds will be at 1600 plus or 2500 plus. So it is always better to have an auto ISO where it will, the light will be, you shouldn't be worrying about it. If your guys are taking it, if you're taking in a manual mode, always keep more than 800.
So
high exposure is easy to come down.
Sure. So there was the another question, like what is the ideal camera settings for taking the birding, doing the birding?
Ideal camera settings, especially when it is bird on flight, it should be 1600 shutter speed or above, depending on the bird. If you're taking a predators, 1600 is beautiful shots. You will get very good background. You will get if you're taking the smaller species of bird, especially a minivet or a nectar feeding birds like sunbirds or a tailor bird, it has to be 2500 and above. ISO, as I told, auto is very good for birding. And if you're not, if you're a manual person, then you have to keep more than 800 until the sun is on the peaks. So that is how you can control the photos. Best settings. These two are the best settings. And again, your lens has to support what you are doing. And you cannot expect high shutter speed with normal kit lenses or a 300mm lens. Because for birding, you need at least 400mm to 600mm lens for you to get very good portrait photos or environmental photos or landscape photos.
Thank you. We have another case, like what are the other question about lens. I'll hold it as of now. Then there is a question about, like, can you share these links? So yes, we will be sharing all these links, including the recording of this session. So no worry on that. We have one more question from Prabhat. The question is that it shows more like that we need to know. So the primarily, I will summarize this question, that how important it is to know the birds, and like if you need to take pictures rather than go and shoot, or you need to study bird behaviors, their habitat and other details, and then do the picture, like then do the photography. So how do you correlate both of these things?
There are two things in this. First thing is that you need to know when it is going to be a season for those kind of birds which you are taking. It is not pigeons or crows. Nowadays, crows are also very difficult for us to find. So you need to know when the bird starts to come to your area and then when it is leaving your area. So a good example would be a black baja. You will not be able to spot that unless there is a pre-monsoon which is coming, like May. So you need to understand the bird's availability, first thing. Second thing is, if you know the behavior of that bird, what time you go there will give you the best shot you can define. I think that would summarize the answer. Is there anything specific?
Yes, sir. So we have now, guys, please put your questions. Try to confine these questions only on related to birding only. We are getting a number of questions regarding lenses, gears. So we have a representative from Sigma who would be talking about some of the lenses, like one of the lens which Sigma makes for birding. We have Mr. Suresh. I'll share the PowerPoint presentation, and Suresh will be answering some of the questions after this presentation. So I'm sharing my screen right now with this PowerPoint presentation. Suresh, please go ahead. This is the first slide open right now.
Yes, sir. And a very good evening to you all. And before I start, I'd like to thank Mr. Ganesh for his very nice presentation with pictures and elaborate about the behavior of the birds and the right time to shoot, as well as he has also given the tips of the lens to be used for the shoots. It was a very nice session, sir. I thank personally you. We will see two interesting lenses, telephoto lenses, which is related to our session today, bird photography. It 150 600 aperture f 5 to 6.3 DG OS HSM. So DG stands for the full frame and OS stands for the optical stabilization. HSM is nothing but hypersonic model. It's an autofocusing system. So there are two models with the same focal length. One we called as contemporary. Another one is sports. We will see some elaborate about what is contemporary and what is sports. We can move to the next slide. Hello? Yes, sir. The choice of lens for shooting preference, because you have two choice. One is sports and the next one is contemporary. Powerful multifunctions. We are going to see what are the powerful multifunctions inbuilt in the lens. And it's even compatible with teleconverters. Okay, we'll see what are the teleconverters available for this 150-600. We can move next, sir. See, there is a small specification presentation here between sports and contemporary. You can see the weight of the lens. Sports, it's 3 kg, and contemporary, it's 1.8, and with the tripod collar, it's 1.9. And front diameter for the sports, it's 105 mm, and for contemporary, it's 95. See, what makes the difference between 95 and 105? With 105, you can get more amount of light to enter through the lens. So when the front dia is more, we can get more light. And not only that, will give good results. The inbuilt optic should be up to our expectations. Sir Mukesh, I think I am getting an echo.
Ganesh, can you mute yourself too? And I'm muting.
Hello.
Yeah, continue, please. I have muted myself.
Okay, sir. Can we go? Hello. Am I clear? Sir, can we go to the previous one, please?
Please continue.
Yes, sir. Go to the previous one, please. Go to the previous slide. The specification slide. The one before this. Yes. See, FLD glass element. In sports, you can see two numbers. In contemporary, we can see one. This FLD, it's a fluorite. It's actually a mineral through which they make optics. This FLD is equivalent to L-series lenses in Canon and neon lenses in Nikon. So what makes the difference between two glass and one glass? When they use two glass, the entry of light will be more because it's a very thin glass. FLD is nothing but a very thin element in which the entry of light from one point to another point, it meets the same thing. It won't split. So you won't get vignetting, distortions and all. In contemporary, we use one. And sports model is, as we discussed yesterday, all the sports series comes with the dust and the splash proof. In sports, we have at eye level. In contemporary, we have at simple level. Why we called as eye and simple? In the next slide, we will be seeing that. Water and oil repellent coating. This is most interesting. When you are when the front element, sometimes if it's split with the water or an oil, you can simply wipe it out. It won't merge with the lens. It won't affect the lens. It's coated. Tripod socket. Normally, when you are mounting a 3 kg sports lens on a tripod from landscape to portrait, if you want to change from portrait to landscape, there is no need for adjusting the tripod. Simply, you adjust, just loosen the tripod socket, tilt the camera to a portrait or a landscape. Just simply tilt the camera without adjusting the tripod to a landscape or a portrait direction. In contemporary, we need to adjust with the tripod, not like the sports one. We can move to the next one, sir. Sports, it's for all challenging shooting conditions, highly durable. Why we call as challenging shooting and highly durable? Next slide, sir. See, this is the reason we called as highly challenging and durable. It's a completely a metal case. It's not a plastic or it's not a fiber. 150, 600 sports, or there are two more lenses in sports series. One is 7200 and 60mm to 600mm. That's also a new lens which covers 600mm focal length, but it starts from 60mm. This lens, it starts from 150mm. All the sports series are completely a metal case, metal component. Next slide, sir. See, all the elements on the sport series is covered with the rubber seal. So it protects from dust, and the splash proof is there. It's not a waterproof, so in the water, it's a splash proof. Next slide, sir. So we have seen the sports. So it's for a challenging condition and durability. It's completely metal case, and each and every element is covered with a rubber seal. So for a traveler who travels in a different climatic conditions or different temperatures, he can use that. Contemporary is for a lightweight who want to carry a light lens. They don't want to carry a heavy lens. For some aged people, they may be interested in wildlife and bad photography, but they want the lens to be compact and lightweight, but with the same focal length, they can go for this contemporary lineup. Same focal length, 150, 600. There is no change in the focal length. There is no change in the aperture. Same 5 to 6.3. Only the light weight. Next one, sir. So there is an option to remove the tripod socket from this, and it comes with an accessories included in the box. You can put a rubber and cover the portion of the tripod. So even with that, without the tripod socket, you can handle. It's easy for handled photography. There won't be any disturbing. The tripod cover won't disturb you while shooting it. Next slide, sir. See, there is a lock system, because when we are positioning like this, if you want to lock it, you can lock in each focal length. The locking possibility in each focal length. Like you can lock at 150mm, you can lock at 200mm, you can lock at 300mm. So in each focal length, you can lock it so that the lens won't go back. Next slide, sir. This is the thing which I want to explain. This is without coating, this is with coating. You can see clearly the two pictures. Without coating, it merge with the lens. So you can't able to easily wipe it out. But with the coating, you can easily wipe it out. It won't merge with the lens. For a sports series, the front element and the rear element, both comes with a water and oil repellent coating. For contemporary, it's only the front element, not the rear one. Next slide, sir. Next. Hello. Hello. Yes. See, there are three functions on the focus. No. One before this, please. Yes. A focus, you have three options. One is autofocus. MO stands for manual override. and MF stands for completely manual. So we already know what is autofocus and what is manual focus. What is MO, manual override? See, normally when in autofocus, if you want to change the focus point, you can do it, but you can't do it on keeping in it in AF. So if you want to do any focus change while it's in autofocus, please switch on to the MO. Don't keep it on AF and try that. Please go to the MO so that you can change the position, the point of autofocus, even with autofocus function. Next slide, sir. OS 1 and 2. In Nikon, we called as VR, and Canon, I called as IR. That means image stabilization, vibration reduction. In Sigma, we called as optical stabilization. Why it's 1 and 2? See, normally panning shots, like flying shots, bird flying shots, we need to go for 2. If it is standing in a position, then you can simply keep it on 1. So basically for panning, it's better to go with the OF 2 option. If you don't want to use OF, when you don't want to use the OF means normally when the lens is mounted on the tripod, we need to switch it off. Okay. So putting it in a tripod and don't switch on the OS function, then you will have shake on your images. Okay. So when the lens is on the tripod, it should be in off. And always when you are using this kind of telephoto lenses, the reason for giving a tripod collar is to mount the lens on the tripod, not the body, because it should be balanced. Because you may be using a light body, lightweight body, but you can see this lens as a 2 kg and 3 kg options. In sports, it's 3 kg and contemporary is 2 kg. So better to mount the lens on the tripod, not the body. Next slide, sir. So as I told, we have teleconverters for this. Even the teleconverters comes with the SLD glass, special low dispersion glass. Okay. TC1401 stands for 1.4x teleconverter. TC2001 stands for 2x teleconverter. Even this is dust and flash proof. That's on the mount part. And some people ask this question, sir, when I use a teleconverter, whether it supports autofocus? Yes, it supports autofocus, but only up to aperture f8, not above that. And this teleconverters are tested with our MTF measuring system called A1, which is a standard measuring system for Sigma. We use 46 megapixels to test the result quality. Next slide, sir. Yeah, these are the two teleconverters, TC1401 and TC2001. 2001 stands for 2x and TC1401 stands for 1.4x. And this is available for Canon and Nikon, both mount. Next slide. I think most of them who attended the yesterday class must be aware of this USB dock. This USB dock, we can update the firmware by ourselves. There is no need for coming to the service center for any firmware updates. You can simply do it on your own. And it's an online free software. And you can adjust the focusing areas. See, normally when you're going for outdoor with a tele lens, you may be shooting up to 10 feet or your subject may be at 10 feet, but sometimes the focus shift to 20 feet or 30 feet. So unnecessary the time, the time consumption, we need to have a time consumption and we need to have a quick focus so that we can give priority for the focusing area. So you can select your focus area. I want my focus to be till 10 feet, not more than that. Or I want my focus to be from 10 feet to infinity. So you can position it using this USB dock. And you can adjust the OS, optical stabilization power, using this USB dock. So these things can be controlled. And even you have a customization option on the lens, C1 and C2, where you can program the focal length, the focusing speed, everything can be controlled. All this can be done with this simple equipment called USB dock, which comes around list price 5,000 rupees. You can do a lot with this. Next slide, sir. This one more unique one, and there is a mount conversion option. If I have a Nikon lens, but recently I purchased a Canon body, do I need to buy a new lens, new Canon mount? No. If you bring this Nikon mount to the service center, we can change the mount to Canon. It's a cost included. Okay, charges, you can call us. The direct service technicians will explain what will be the cost to change the mounts. Okay, from Canon to Nikon or Nikon to Canon, you can change the mounts. Next one, sir. As I told you, this lens comes with a 9-blade diaphragm. See the difference between 9 and the 8. 8, you will see the hexagon, but in 9, you can have a spherical round shape. And our coatings avoid flaring, because mostly when you are taking bird, you will face a problem of this, the picture on the left-hand side. No super multi-coated layer. You will have a flare and a ghost feel. But with our coating, you can't able to see that flare or a ghosting when you are taking boats. And this is my last slide. And thank you so much for giving this opportunity. Now we will go to the question answer session. Mukesh, can I answer all the questions?
Unmuted.
Sure. You can read the questions as soon as they are coming. And meanwhile, we can start with Ganesh. With some
okay.
Ganesh.
Oh, I will answer.
Yeah, so anything coming to for the camera questions, this I'll connect with you. And general questions, I'm making Ganesh again as a presenter. So Ganesh, one of the very basic question, not specific to, like, which is being asked a lot of time. What is the best lens, or what is the minimum level of lens? Minimum, like in tele lens, which is required for birding?
So the minimum lens which is required is 400 mm. So there is a echoing, that's it. So the minimum lens which is required is 400 mm. So those who can't afford any prime lenses, they can use Sigma 150-600, Tamron 150-600. So these two lenses give very good photos, and you can be more closer to the birds.
And there is a question, like, can we do bird photography with 70 to 200, which is usually owned by a lot of wedding and street and fashion photographers?
It's actually very difficult for a 200 mm lens. You will get the whole environment, the whole background and the subject. Birds are very small. You're not like having a mammal's photo. So for mammals or cats, we can use 200 mm. But for birds, it is better to have 400 to 600 mm range.
Okay. Question is there for Suresh from Jitesh. Is it recommended to use extenders for shoots with the lens?
Using an extender will reduce the image quality for sure, because when you are using a 1.4x teleconverter or a 2x teleconverter, your f-stop will also increase. Not only your focal length, even your f-stop goes higher. Because 150-600 is already a 5.6.3. So if you are using a 1.4x teleconverter, it goes more than 8. So if you are completely going to shoot in manual, you can prefer teleconverter, but for autofocus, my advice without teleconverter will be best.
And can you also give an idea about the cost of these two lenses?
Yeah, I am sharing it. The list price, the MRP price for the contemporary is 95, and for the sports it's 197,000. As I told you, please contact your nearest dealer, because the dealer will play with their margin. As a distributor, we normally won't sell directly to the end users. So sure, for sure, you will get a very good deal from the dealers network.
Good. Ganesh, we have a question. How to get prepared when we are going for a birding, like birding? And that includes like what to wear, what not to wear. Is it good to wear some kind of fragrances, deos, or so just, you know, like a overall view that what to do and what not to do, yeah. That is more important.
Yeah, actually birds can see four colors. So it doesn't matter what to wear, basically. It might be a camouflage, a fluorescent, a white, a red, a pink. It doesn't matter for birds because they can see four colors. Unlike mammals or cats, which they can see only in the shades of gray, birds can see four colors. So whichever thing you wear, it doesn't matter for them. Fragrance, it is your choice. Soaps, toothpaste, etc. I don't know. Toothpaste, you're not going to go near the bird and blow. So I don't think so. It is going to be a difference. And most of the time, birds are more than 600 feet away from you or 400 feet away from you. So the deos what you wear, if you are there for more than an hour or so, the smell would have already gone down. This is only for birding.
How about wearing those camouflage t-shirts or hats? Like, does that help?
Yeah, it helps only to some extent. Maybe to the shore birds or the birds which are on the ground. But one which is flying, which are perching, it doesn't matter for them.
Okay. Is there any wildlife photography school? This is another question. Is there any wildlife photography school?
There are photography schools in India which they explain or they teach about all sorts of photography, but not specifically for wildlife, because it is more of time consuming and it is more of behavior study. It is not technical or art study for that matter.
Okay. There is a question from Ajay. I have been to Pulicat area. As you walk towards a cluster of birds, they start flying off. I think it happens everywhere. How much time would be required for birds to feel comfortable?
Yeah. So this is very important when you are going towards the cluster of birds. So cluster of birds, even if one bird flies, all the bird flies. It is a simple logic for them. One bird fly or the bird fly. Even chumma they start to fly also, all the birds will fly. So you would have seen with flamingos, you would have seen with barred-headed geese, it might be with starlings. One bird flies, every bird flies. So you have to always walk parallel towards the birds. You have to settle down wherever you are and move every 10 minutes. You cannot keep on moving towards the bird easily. So every 5 minutes or 8 minutes, you can see the timings. Once the bird starts seeing you there, you can move a little front and sit for some more time. Then you move front and sit for some more time. After a while, you will be like 200 meters away from the birds.
Okay, nice. Another question we have. Guys, anyone of you want to have a question on voice, please raise your hand. So this question is like about the binocular. What do you suggest about the binocular? Is it must have, should have, or good to have? And if yes,
I have a specs. So I'm already away from the binoculars when it is sitting on my eyes. So for me, I feel best is 8 times magnification into 42 or 46. So very few of them will give 46, but 8 into 42, the view angle is very good. So you get 270 degree of view angle and you can almost have 8 times magnification in that. in 10 to 50, what happens is most of the time, the light coming, this is same with all the lens factors, including our cameras and stuff. So the light coming in is very less, and 10 times magnification you get with the 50, 10 times zoom with 50 times magnification. So you have to concentrate. You need to have a tripod to make it settle to your eyes, or a monopod. With 8x42, you don't have to have any kind of stabilization on your hands. You just have to hold it, you will be okay. And for the question, Pentax 1050 is good. It gives you good colors, same saturation color. And you can, if you are not wearing glasses, it is much more easy for you to spot the bird. If you are wearing glasses, for any person for that matter, those who are wearing glasses, it will be little difficult for them to focus on the exact point where they are seeing the bird.
Next question we have from Sir Faroz. Suppose you are unmuted, you can ask your question. Seems like network issue with him. We can go to the next question. Any tips to shoot and tell a story in the birding photography, and without getting on the way with others such as officers, biologists? Any tip to get the shots that tell the story while photographing in the field?
Actually, officers and biologists, I'm not getting in what terms he's asking.
Not very clear, but I guess what he meant, that how to, you know, like how to work, deal with officers when he say, I think he mean by rangers or forest officers. But I guess for birding, there are not much of the restrictions, what I believe.
No, there is no restrictions. Only in 2-3 places there is restrictions. But if you go a day in advance and get the permission, you can go. They are not going to block. And biologists will not block anything. It's only the range officers who are there. And where there is a village within the perimeter of the birding in the nesting area.
Another question is like about the birding ethics. Like some people, they try to move the their nest, or you know, like or some certain kind. What is ethical? What is not? What's your view on that?
So actually, birding needs to be very ethical. You're not supposed to touch the nest. You're not supposed to shoot the nest and post it with the area where you are shot. You can keep the nesting. You can post it later in the year, not at the time of when it is breeding. Because all the people will rush into that one area to get that shot. So it is not advised at all. So other than that, you can actually talk to the people over there, especially with the keepers or the forest watchers, and ask them when is the time to get the best birds which are on the ground, especially those who are running behind barred-headed geese, flamingos, and these kind of birds. The localites or the people who are safeguarding the borders, they have better information to tell you, and you can give your numbers to them. You might have to give them 50 rupees, 100 rupees, which will help you guys in the morning or whenever it comes, you will get the call and you will be the first person to be there.
Ganesh, would you be able to share, as per you, although it's a debatable question, but what are the top 5 parks or places to shoot birds in India?
In shooting birds, actually parks we don't have, places we have. So LRK is there, first one, Gujarat. We have Pulikat Lakes. We have Magdi Lake in Karnataka, Pulikat in Tamil Nadu. Periyar Reserve, Thattekadu. Thattekadu is in Kerala. So you are covering four different parts. You have in Pune, Malsaj Ghat area. So that also is very good for birding. Western Ghats is very good for birding. Mm-hmm. These are a few places where you can do very good birding. Assam, Kaziranga, Manas, you have